game is 49ers and Seattle, and the 49ers were eliminated in that game, and part of the conversation the next day is what Troy Aikman and Joe Buck were lighting up Ed Hockley and the officiating crew for right on the spot was that roughing the passer penalty that gave a fresh set of downs to a team that was about to kick a field goal and only go up six. Seattle went up by 10, and the rest is history. Mike Pereira joining us here once again on the Rich Eisen Show in his usual Monday spot here in studio. It's good to see you, sir.
Always good to be here.
Moments later, you seconded that emotion, correct?
Yeah, where was I when it happened, though? I mean, I was actually doing a little KFC spot in another studio, and they called me out. They said, they need you. Run over, look at this thing. And then I hopped on.
Well, Mike, there's only one Mike Pereira.
I guess.
You know what I mean? You got to tell everybody there's only one Mike Pereira.
Yeah.
And I'm glad that we have him here. But you agree that that was a poor call?
Yeah. And you know, I mean, I understand that things happen at a fast pace and fast speed, and referees have to make decisions, you know, in a split second. But the fact is, you can't hit a quarterback high and you can't hit him low. You've got a target area, and that target area is the chest. And that was a wrap and tackle. And yes, there was some incidental hairline helmet. That's not to be called. And I think I'm actually happy that Dean Blandino stepped up and said it was not a good call, you know, because you have to be able to hit the quarterback somehow. It wasn't late. And I just think it was a poor call in a critical time, and it'll lead to a lot of discussion in the offseason.
Well, I want to get to that right now. Dean Blandino, as you're referring to, the current head of NFL refs, which you were back in the day, and he went on NFL AM this morning on America's Most Watched NFL Network, and he said that it was the wrong call, and then he was asked about the mechanics, what he's looking for in his officials for a call like this, and this is what he said.
Well, certainly if he doesn't see the whole action, we don't want him to throw the flag. And Ed was getting into position, and he saw him, or what he thought he saw, ducking the head and making
right.
the contact. And so he wouldn't throw the flag if he didn't see it. But it obviously happens quick at full speed, and he doesn't have the benefit of the slow-motion replays that we all do after the fact.
And that's the last part I want to talk to you about, the benefit of the slow-motion replays that we all do after the fact. It's there. It's to be used. Marvin Lewis at the top of this hour said he, speaking on behalf of what he believes is the competition committee general sense, doesn't want this stuff replayed. But where are we going to go, Mike, if these things aren't replayed, except talk about this stuff day in and day out when it can be fixed?
Yeah, I'm a huge Marvin Lewis fan.
Me too.
I don't agree with him. I mean, I think that, you know, you have to take a look at the big picture here and realize that you are reviewing illegal touching of a kick, which is a 5-yard previous spot penalty. And you're not reviewing these, what I would refer to as high impact calls that result in 15-yard penalties or more.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's come to a point now where you need to expand your view on replay. And, you know, maybe, you know, I don't think that the competition committee maybe should be a position that a guy could be on for 12 years. I think maybe you need some new thoughts, new voices, and new perspective of things. But to me, I am now for these hits on defensive players to be reviewed. But I'll let you push that one. Me, if you're gonna say that that's gonna be reviewable, then how can you not say that pass interference should be reviewable?
Well, Mike, you know,
because
my position.
That could be a 40-yard penalty.
Review
You're
it all.
You're talking 15 years. I don't say review at all. I'm not at all there. I don't want offsides to be reviewed. I don't want illegal motion to be reviewed. But I would say this. If the coaches are paranoid, they don't want to make more decisions on whether or not they should or shouldn't challenge a play. Okay? I get that. They have enough decisions to make. Put it in the hand of the replay official like it is right now on turnovers and scores. Make it an automatic thing that they look at, and they can get involved without the coach's challenge and move on, because we've opened Pandora. He says, you don't want to open Pandora's box. Marvin Lewis says, it's open.
It is open.
It's already open.
Mike Pereira of Fox Sports is here. And here's, again, I want to just delve into this. As you mentioned, is it that the site, because you've been in these meeting rooms, the composition committee, is it the psyche of a control freak coach that just, it's one more thing that's out of his control to decide whether to challenge something or not. There's too much to worry about, or it's just out of his control what's being looked at underneath the hood and the conversation that's being had between New York and the officials, and they're not part of this thing. Is that part of the reason why somebody on a competition committee would say, let's not review this sort of stuff?
You know, I look at it, I think the competition committee has the best interests of the game at heart. I think, though, and you have a makeup that's interesting because you have head coaches, you have club execs, and you have owners.
Like John Mara sitting on there?
Sure, you have a pretty diverse group represented in the thing. And I do think that they have the best interests in the game, but here's what they probably don't listen enough to, in my opinion, and that's the fans. I mean, that's the fans who are basically supporting the game by watching it on television or by sitting in stadiums and enduring delays, and they're not listening to those people. And I think you have to, and I think the mechanism is there. I think from the coach's standpoint, they just don't want to be put in a position where they have to make more decisions. It was so hard to get a simple rule change in allowing a coach to make a decision to defer his option on the coin toss and take the ball at the start of the second half of the kickoff because they told me, we don't want to make the decision.
This is what was said to you in a...
Yes, and a lot of coaches that I talked to when I was trying to get that rule passed. And I think that, you know, the time has come where you got to take a little different approach.
The RG3 play, Mike Pereira, the Washington quarterback with hardly any time left at the end of the first half, dives for the pylon. It's ruled a touchdown on the field. After further review, it looks like the ball, he loses it as he's reaching for the pylon, and thus, when he possessed it again, he was out of bounds in the end zone. And thus, that's not a touchdown? You agree that that's not a touchdown?
Yeah, I knew it immediately when I saw that replay right there. And I called into the truck immediately on the communication I have with them. I said, tell them they're going to reverse this to a touchback. And it's so hard for people to understand this because they look at RG3 as a runner. Mm-hmm. And the best way to do it is that when RG3 loses possession of the ball, and now, in order to get possession back, it's just like making a catch. It's like catching the fumble. The ball is loose, so you have to catch the fumble. The same rules as catching a pass. So if you possess it and get 2 feet down, but you're going to the ground, it's that old process. You have to hold on to the ball when you hit the ground, and RG3 didn't. So it's like catching a pass. Catching a fumble, it means the same thing.
So when he caught it again and he was out of bounds in the end zone, that's where it's like fumbling the ball out of the end zone.
The ball came out, so he didn't maintain possession. And the interesting thing is, you know, Santana Moss went nuts.
Have you heard through the grapevine what he said to Triple?
No, but I, as my comment on to a radio station in Washington, D.C. this morning was, I understand the frustration, but he went after Jeff Triplett, he went after the wrong guy. It's Dean Blandino that made that decision. They should have caught a short flight to New York and went after Dean Blandino.
Yeah,
they didn't
gonna...
like the decision.
Yeah,
but it's, and they made the right call. They made the right call. It's unfortunate and frustrating, but they made the right call.
And then the Aaron Rodgers fumble at the end of the Packers-Bills game, we were all sitting there watching, why are they blowing that play dead? Why are they blowing a play dead when the ball's rolling on the ground and Eddie Lacy's got it in his hands? And the reason why is the moment Eddie Lacy picked it up, that's the end of the play?
Credit Dave Casper.
Yeah.
Back to the holy roller play when the Raiders beat San Diego on a freak play when Kenny Stabler was ruled to have fumbled, and then Casper muffed it forward, and finally recovered it in the end zone for a touchdown. That next season, the rules maker looked at it and said, that doesn't seem right. So they came up with the fumble rule inside of 2 minutes, which said that if you did a bad thing as a player and fumble, then we're going to only let you be the player, the only player that could pick it up in advance. And if any of your teammates recovered the ball after you fumbled it, inside of 2 minutes only, or on fourth down, the play's dead immediately. And in this particular play, when Eddie Lacy picked it up, even though it was behind the spot of the fumble, the play's over at that point because it wasn't Aaron Rodgers that picked it up, and that's why the safety was ruled.
So Bill Levy did what few people in Seattle would say about him, which he nailed it.
Yeah, and I actually said that right away. I thought it's an unusual play, and a lot of times in that situation when it does happen, you will see the officials, their natural instinct is to let it play out, but he killed it immediately. He was right on top of the rule. which was really great because it is an unusual play.
You breezed right past my sarcastic sort of subversive comment on Super Bowl 40.
No, I heard it because I've heard it a lot of times.
I know
you
did.
From Bill Levy.
When I went to the Pro Bowl right after that for NFL Network, and Matt Hasselbeck was the quarterback, says to me, "Where's Pereira? Why isn't he on yet?" Yeah. You went on vacation, didn't you?
Went to the beach. I caught the first plane the next morning to Costa Rica. I went zip gliding. after that. The only way I could get away.
We did get you on Total Access a week later.
Yes, you did.
We
after
did.
I came back from Costa Rica.
And Hasselbeck spent the whole week in Hawaii accusing us of being the NFL's Al Jazeera.
Yes,
is what he said to me.
I must tell you, worse than Hasselbeck was his mother, who attacked me at a lead function.
I love it. Don't mess with Betsy.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern. On Audience.